We have the Amiga 1200. It's a personal one of mine that I bought off eBay. And the first thing I did when I got it was that disassembling it, make sure that all the components are in order. So let's try and open it up and see how it looks. So, first thing you need to be careful with though, when opening up an Amiga, is that you have this ribbon cable connected to the motherboard, and you need to carefully disconnect that, like so. And put it away. And you also have these cables for the LEDs, and we can also just disconnect that. Make sure that when you connect it again, black should also be left, and we can put it away. There we go. So, first thing that I did when I got it was that I installed these new Kickstart ROMs. You can get these off Amiga Kit on the web, and that's where I got these from. But there's also other places where you can get them. This is mainly so you're able to install and use the latest Amiga Workbench. Another thing I installed was an accelerator card. Now the Amiga has a really nice processor in the 1200 compared to the Amiga 500. However, I still wanted to be able to multitask a lot. I wanted to be able to have it run and boot really fast, and also be able to pull off some of the Amiga CD games. And the only way I was able to do that was to install an accelerator card. Another thing I did was that I installed this compact flash as a hard drive. Now, when you open it up as a completely new Amiga, you have this metal shield covering the whole thing, and then you have these drive bays where you can install hard drives. However, finding hard drives that fits the standard that the Amiga goes with can be very expensive in today's like market. So going for a compact flash solution, which works fine, is way cheaper and outweighs like all the pros from going with a standard hard drive. Underneath here we have the flicker fixer. One thing that has always been a thing on the Amiga is that if you connect it to a non-CRT monitor, you would normally get flickering and other things that might be annoying. So this module here fixes that, and as a bonus, it also makes it possible to run at a higher resolution in Workbench. And probably the best thing, and the thing I love the most about it, is that you're able to use DVI now. So you could actually use a DVI to HDMI and connect it to the TV. So that is all connected via ribbon cables here and nicely tucked away. This has a bit of cardboard on it, so it doesn't short circuit when it's assembled. That is mostly all that I have installed in this Amiga. Everything else is completely standard. So that is really all you need when you want to when you want to use an Amiga in today's standard. You can also get the cards you slot in to the side, like credit card things, where you can have Ethernet, so you can actually load up internet on your Amiga. And you can go on the web on an Amiga today. But if you want to find out more about that, you can check out like a YouTuber like Cookie Tech, who has a lot of that stuff. So the operating system of the Amiga is called Amiga Workbench. And back in the day, you normally got it on a couple of floppy disks when you bought the Amiga, and you could just boot up the first floppy disk and you had the bare minimum operating system to write stuff in or load up other games, stuff like that. However, if you had a hard drive in the Amiga, you could install it on there and use it as an operating system like you do today with Windows or Mac or Linux. So a cool thing about the operating system for the Amiga is that it was super powerful for multitasking back in the day. It was completely unheard of when it was released that you could run multiple things at once and without significant impact on the performance. So let's demonstrate this by loading up some music. And then we can also load up something like a file manager on the Amiga called Dopus. Now Dopus runs full screen, so how do I get back to the desktop? Now I could just minimize it. However, the Amiga has something really fancy where you could just lower it down all the way to the bottom if you wanted to, and then you could move stuff around and move it back up. And you could even take the desktop and move that down if you had, for instance, a game running behind it. So, as I've mentioned, I have a hard drive installed on this, and with a system called WHD load, I can have multiple games on the hard drive. These games are, most of them are abandonware as it is right now. However, other games we have at the office, we have the games in retail. So it's basically just the floppy disks on the hard drive. But there's a whole community of people who have managed to get it working on the hard drive, so we don't have to fiddle around with floppy disks. So we could load up a game. Let's try something like Rough and Tumble. Now, if you have a good amount of games on it, it takes a little bit to load the directories, since it is an Amiga and it's not like the fastest thing in the world. But it still beats having to fiddle around with floppy disks. Let's try it out. Right, so here we have Rough and Tumble loading up. And it loads significantly faster while running from the hard drive than it does from a diskette or floppy. And this makes it possible to even add small patches into the game. For instance, for Rough and Tumble, you can check a box when it's loading up, and then if you have a gamepad with more than two buttons on it, you can actually change the jump to be a button press instead of you having to press up to jump. Now that was a really default thing in Amiga games back in the day, that you had to press up to jump. However, in a platformer, it can get a bit annoying that you don't have a dedicated button for the jump. So one thing that inspired us to actually start the Rad Rodgers as a project was that we one evening were at Fred's place and we played Rough and Tumble. We really want to try out the same amount of action that you get in a game like Rough and Tumble or Jim Powers. However, we didn't want to be crippled by the same things that you had back in the day, where you had to resort to improvise when you want to do directional shooting. And we didn't want to shoot in 40 degree angles, because that's also something we found out while playing around in the game, that if you had flying enemies and they weren't exactly at the angle, it could get a bit annoying trying to find the right position and stuff like that. So whack them back into that castle.
Yes, get back in there.
Be gone, our demons.
No armor whatsoever.
Your life is going down, what is that, flesh? What is that health bar?
I don't know, I think it's a tattoo. They keep coming. They have like bicycle helmets on.